All right, folks, we're going to get started. Well, thank you for coming to our panel on Randall with Louisville Anime Community. Basically, probably if you've seen an anime history panel before, it kind of starts out with Son of Kazuko, the Master Boy. Kind of sets up where might see a couple of slides and do some stuff. I've got about 7,000 words to go through in an hour, so actually less than an hour. So I'm going to pretty much try to just run this as a narrative, and if there's any questions in that, if we've got any time left, I'll be happy to take care of those, or we can come out in the hall and take care of it out there too. So with that, we'll get started.
Would you have your camera closed?
Sure. I was kind of worried about that myself. Usually when we in the West begin to learn about the history of anime, we begin with Osamu Tezuka. And to a certain extent, that's a perfect place to start. Anime, as we all know it now, began with Tezuka's style and production methods and everyone in Japan following his lead. But prior to 1961, when Tezuka began making anime for TV, Japan had been creating animation for nearly a half century already. The information available on Japanese animation before 1950, at least in English, is limited at best and conflicting at worst. Actual animated films themselves, as well as the records of who created what and when, was mostly destroyed. This is due to 1923's Great Kanto Earthquake, and later the American invasion of the islands. Aside from that, animation was treated as disposable entertainment, as was most animation in the rest of the world at the time. Thus, little has survived. Thankfully, one of the animated works that remains, or of the animated work that remains, has been preserved digitally as available online. When film began to spread throughout Japan, rather than accepting it as an evolution of photography as the West did, it was viewed as an extension of theater. Since kabuki, no, and bunraku theater traditions all had narrators, naturally film needed one as well. Enter the Benshi, a narrator who not only read aloud the on-screen intertitles, but also described the film's events in real time and gave voice to each and every character. The Three Fathers in 1907 to 1923, film first hit Japan in 1896 and had flourished into culture in the 1910s, complete with film criticism. Along with the initial wave of films from the West came Western animation. It was only a matter of time before Japan, with its rich visual culture, began experimenting with its own animated creations. The earliest example, speculated to be the oldest surviving anime, is Katsudo Sashin, moving picture from 1907 to 1918, supposedly. In the early 1900s, animators experimented with inexpensive ways to bring their visions to life. Katsudo Sashin and many others were drawn directly onto the strips of film from which they were projected, making these animations one of a kind. This and other early animation techniques were pioneered by Oten Shimokawa, a political cartoonist for Tokyo Puck magazine. His first animated work, Imokawa Mukuzo, The Story of the Concierge, from 1917, was long believed to be the first animated short made in Japan, though it's likely still the first short ever screened for a wide audience. After creating only five shorts, chronic health problems forced Shimokawa into early retirement. His contribution, however, gives him the honors one of the early three fathers of anime. The second of the three fathers was Junichi Kyoichi, who holds the honor of the oldest confirmed anime in existence. Katsudo Sashin could have been made as early as 1907, but there's no real proof to its age. Nakamura Gintana, or Dull Sword, from 1917, is a two-minute short about a samurai attempting to test his newly purchased katana on the innocent townspeople and failing miserably. This film was thought to be lost until a copy was found in Osaka at antique shop in 2008. Koichi animated this short using paper cutouts laid out on a table, which he moved and changed to create the character's movements. This was a technique that would later be taken to a level of artistic excellence by the Japanese animation directors of the 1930s. Junichi Koichi began creating political propaganda in 1924 and then retired from animation in 1930. The third father of this generation had arguably the most impact on the generation that followed him, mostly because he had the largest body of work and many animators of the 1930s were his students. Sitaro Kitayama created shorts focusing on Japanese folktales like Sakurane Gassen, which was the monkey crab battle, Urashima Taro, and Momotaro. Aside from creating anime's first commercials and documentary, Kitayama stood apart from his contemporaries as the only animator to found his own studio. Kitayama Ego Sisaikujo opened in 1921 and gave jobs to a slew of talented individuals, including Sane Yamamoto. Sadly, after only 2 years, most of Kitayama's studio was destroyed by the Great Kanto earthquake of 1923. He left Tokyo for a fresh start in Osaka the next year, but eventually abandoned animation completely for a career shooting newsreels. With the destruction of his studio, his team of animators struck out on their own to seek prosperity in personal ventures, but success did not come easily. Throughout the 20s, animation directors faced stiff foreign competition from larger, richer, and more impressive studios overseas. The imported cartoons had already made money in their home countries, so they were sold cheaply to theaters in Japan. Animation artists could not implement the expensive techniques used by Disney and still sell their cartoons at a competitive price. This made the paper cutout methods introduced by Junichi Koichi an absolute must. This limitation, however, led to some extremely innovative cutout films by two men, Yasuji Murata and Noboruro Ofuji. Yasuji Murata began working at the Yokohama Cinema Shokai in 1923, creating the Japanese intertitle cards for imported Western films. After seeing various Western cartoons, he was inspired to create his own in 1927. He worked almost exclusively for the Yokohama Cinema throughout his career. His first work to get attention was Dobutsu Omopiko Takai, or the Anime Olympics, in 1928, a cartoon about funny animals playing sports. However, one of the best examples of his range and artistic skill is The Stolen Lump of 1929. Because foreign cartoons dominated movie theaters at the time, Japanese animation had difficulty finding a venue in which to be screened. A lot of anime from this period was screened in a public shopping areas to generate interest. The Ministry of Education also encouraged Japanese animators to produce films that were either educational or socially uplifting, thus allowing them to be screened in schools. This was the case with Yasuji Murata's Taro-san, or Taro's Train, in 1929. Murata was a master of cutout animation with strengths in skill, quality, and consistency. Murata's opposite was cutout master Noboru Ofuji, whose strengths were in innovation and the willingness to take creative risks. Ofuji became the apprentice of Junichi Koichi at 18 and made his first film at 24. His films are characterized by the use of chiogami paper. Though this gives his films a distinct Japanese look, the choice to use chiogami paper was more practical than artistic. Chiogami was cheaper by far than drawing on expensive celluloid and made it inexpensive paper cutout animation even more affordable. Even after gaining success and resources, Ofuji continued to use chiogami as his medium of choice. Ofuji's achievements went beyond his aesthetic superiority. He was also an innovator. Though films with synchronous soundtracks had been introduced in the United States and Europe in 1927, they did not reach Japan until 1929. This was largely due to opposition from benchy narrators who wanted to hold on to their star status. Though he lacked the resources to create a true talkie, Ofuji created the first record talkie, in which he put to film an animation that synced up perfectly with an existing jazz record. The venue simply had to start the film and the record at the same time, and the audience would see Japan's first sound cartoon, The Black Cat, in 1929. Starting into the 1930s, we get into Ofuji's cartoony stuff, The Tengu Extermination of 1934. It's a great example of Ofuji's foray into cell animation, and it's fascinating to see such familiar cartoon imagery repurposed for Japanese storytelling. This one is similar to a lot of 1930s cartoons, but has samurai, geisha, cute doggy, and Tengu. Our final look at the work of Ofuji is the film that cemented him as a master of animation in the art world, or Kujira, Whale, of 1952. It's a remake of his 1927 silent black and white film, also Whale. The 52 version features cutouts of colored cellophane arranged on a backlit multi-plane animation table. This allowed him to create intricate backgrounds and transitions. The industry continued to struggle, unable to respond adequately to successive innovations, including the appearance of the first talkies in 1929 and the color film in 1932. During this period, Ofuji won international acclaim for The Thief of Bagoda Castle, which he made by cutting and pasting Chiogami together. His film is remembered as the first to make its presence felt outside Japan. One of the first manga characters to gain widespread popularity was Norikuro, created by Suho Tagawa in 1931. The manga focused on a stray dog who joined the dog army, and clearly an allusion to the Imperial Japanese Army. He began his army career as a bumbling private, eventually rose to the ranks to become a less interesting sergeant. The manga and the cartoons it spawned did not start out as propaganda, but as the war began and escalated, Norikuro became an obvious choice for propaganda attainment. Towards the end of the 1930s, most cartoons began to lean in the direction of war propaganda. That is in of itself an interesting study, especially since the quality of Japanese animation began to approach that of Disney. Furthermore, most all the anime from this period was directed by one man, Mitsuo Seo. With war approaching, goods were in extremely short supply as the national mood turned militaristic. Even film was not easy to get a hold of. It was in this context that the full first feature-length film in the history of Japanese anime was released. Momotaro Umi no Shinpei, or Momotaro Divine Sea Warriors of 1945, came out just before the end of the war and was financed by the Japanese Navy. This was a propagandistic film designed to lift morale and commitment to the war effort. Domestic anime production was beginning to develop a small but solid foundation when Tokyo and the surrounding areas suffered catastrophic damage, again, the Great Kanto Earthquake in 1923. The anime industry was forced to start over from scratch. In the 1940s, soon after the war ended, General Headquarters of the Allied Occupation, or the GHQ, brought together 100 anime artists in the bombed-out ruins of Tokyo to form the Shin Nihon Dogasha, or New Japanese Animation Company. The aim was to make it easier to spread occupation policies by having the artists produce anime in the praise of democracy. However, many of the artists were fiercely independent and territorial, and the company was riddled by disagreements from the outset. The project strayed off course and was eventually disbanded. Looking at the start of toy animation, it was during these years, as Japan began to recover from the disastrous war, that Okawa Hiroshi, president of Toei Film Company, saw Disney's Snow White. He was overwhelmed by the gorgeous color of the film. In 1956, he built a modern studio, a white-walled palace with air conditioning, as people called it, and founded Toei Doga, still known as Toei Animation, his ambition to become the Disney of the East. Toei Doga at the time chose Hakujaden, The Legend of the White Snake, as their first film. They sent a research team to the United States and invited several experts to travel to Japan as mentors. As a result, they were able to master the Disney system of assembly line production. They hired a team of new employees who honed their skills while they produced the film under the supervision of veteran animators like Mori Yasuji and Daikuhara Akira. With jobs hard to come by in post-war Japan, the new company was able to attract an outstanding team of young talent, happy to work for relatively low starting salaries. It was a typical labor-intensive company. However, as the government's drive to double people's income started to take effect, wages shot up and the company soon found itself in the red. Attendances at the World Masterpiece Fairy Tale Anime Series, a manga festival, held every year during the springtime school holidays, and eventually in later years during the summer vacation as well, were failing. The company's financial future was uncertain. The labor movement was also gaining momentum, bringing frequent labor disputes and labor management clashes. Takahata Isao and Miyazaki Hayao, now with Studio Ghibli, began their careers at Toei Animation. Both were active members of the labor union, Takahata serving as vice chairman and Miyazaki as secretary general. However, destiny chose Osamu Tezuka as the god of manga, and by extension, anime. And no one can say he doesn't deserve that title. Anime's characteristic big eyes came from Tezuka's fascination with Disney's Bambi, and its signature character movements came from Tezuka's plan to temporarily limit animation to cut costs, a plan that eventually became permanent and was adopted by the entire industry. There's a good reason that most retellings of anime's history begin with Tezuka. What we now know as anime started with him. However, a history of animation is not complete without Kyoichi, Kitayama, Murata, Ofuji, and many others. These artists are seldom remembered, though they are worked exceptionally hard to compete with well-funded foreign animation. All of them succeeded and created Japanese art in an imported foreign medium, and a few of them succeeded in turning their practical limitations into artistic assets. These artists are mostly forgotten because of the influence they have on our present is much less than the ongoing influence of Osamu Tezuka. Getting into the 1960s, Toei's first few features followed the Disney formula very closely. They were produced a year apart. They were based on popular folk tales, the Oriental rather than the European, and the heroes had many cute, funny animal companions. The first six were distributed in America, usually a couple years after they were first shown in Japan. The second through sixth, with their American titles but Japanese release years, were Magic Boy in 59, Alakazam the Great in 60, The Littlest Warrior in 61, The Adventures of Sinbad in 62, and The Little Prince and Eight-Headed Dragon in 1963. Unfortunately, these were not successful in the U.S., and Japanese theatrical animation disappeared from America for the next two decades, unless it could be sold to TV as an afternoon children's movie. But Alakazam the Great led to something unexpected. Although directed by Yabushita, it was based on a popular 1950s comic book adaptation by Osamu Tezuka of the ancient Chinese Monkey King legend. The young Tezuka was Japan's most popular comic strip and comic book artist of the 1950s, who virtually invented Japan's modern manga industry. Since the movie used his plot and visual style, he was consulted on its adaptation and became involved with its promotion. This caused him to switch his attention from comic books to animation. Tezuka was also impressed by the appearance in Japan of the first Hanna-Barbera television cartoons of the late 1950s, which led him to conclude that he could produce limited animation for the new TV market. More importantly, he realized from the popularity of his comic books, especially such future titles as Astro Boy, that there was a strong demand for modern, fast-paced fantasy, which the animation establishment and its narrow focus on fairy tales and antique storybook settings was completely ignoring. As a result, Tezuka organized Japan's first TV animation studio, Mushi Productions, and its first major release was a weekly series based upon Astro Boy, which debuted on New Year's Day in 1963. It was such an instant success that by the end of 1963, there were three more television animation studios in production, and Toei Animation had opened a TV division. By the end of the 1960s, the popularity of TV science fiction or action-adventure anime was so overwhelming that Toei began to alternate it with fairy tale fare for its theatrical features. Television animation became much more popular in Japan than it ever was in America. This was largely due to Tezuka's influence. He had drawn in just about every medium available, including children's picture books, romance comic books, soap operas for women's magazines, risque humor for men's magazines, political cartoons for newspapers. He established the attitude that cartooning was an acceptable form of storytelling for any age group, and this is in sharp contrast to the United States, where the attitude became cartoons and comic books are only for children. When Astro Boy aired, the show became a surprise hit, starting the anime boom in a period of intense competition for TV audiences. The success marked the beginning of a new kind of anime industry. The low franchise fees paid to the studio for Astro Boy meant that the company needed to come up with a way to drastically cut production costs. They ruthlessly cut the number of drawings, trimmed the number of lines in each image to the bare minimum, and took to using more still images. They worked to make the storylines quicker and devised clever ways of simulating movement from sound effects to the dialogue. The company offset its losses with copyright income, licensing the rights for the Adam character to their corporate sponsor, confectionery maker Meiji Seika, who used the character on popular brands of chocolates. When the company still posted a loss, Tezuka decided to invest his own income from manga publishing. It was a generous gesture typical of the man they called the god of manga. In 1965, another big Japanese series made it to the North American television. It was called Gigantor in English, and in Japan it was Tetsujin 28. The series introduced a boy and his robot genre. Astro Boy and Gigantor were followed by many others, but despite its initial popularity, anime was soon on its way out in the West. and by late 1960s, it had pretty much vanished from American television altogether. In the 1970s, merchandising became entrenched as a part of the basic business model for all television anime that followed. The most popular genre dealt with science fiction and space, followed by shows about girls with magical powers. In 1968, the popular baseball-themed Star of the Giants began, followed in 69 by the first episode of the family drama Sazae-san, which continues to this day as the longest-running series in anime history. But not every series could be a winner, and with a glut on the market, competition intensified. At Toei Animation, which continued to run a deficit due to high production costs, labor management relations deteriorated, leading to a lockout and layoffs in the summer of 72. Mushi Production went bankrupt in 73. The anime industry went into recession. Behind this recession were larger economic issues, such as the Nixon shock of 71 and the 73 oil crisis. When an animated television series ended, the staff was disbanded. Toei's seniority-based employment system fell apart, and they switched to a system of performance-based pay. They were required to change to a corporate style that was more compatible with the shrewd programming policies of the television studios. Amidst the recessionary mood of these bleak years, a new work appeared that challenged the idea of anime as simply children's entertainment. Space Battleship Yamato, released as a TV series in 74 and then as a feature film in 77, became a social phenomenon, tremendously popular with millions of young adults. In 79, there was a surge of interest in science fiction in the U.S., prompted by Star Trek and Star Wars. The interest opened the way for foreign science fiction, including anime. In this climate, Space Battleship Yamato arrived in America as a heavily edited Star Blazers. Its impact was immense. Around the same time, cable TV became increasingly common and affordable home video beta and VHS players appeared on the market. Together, these events opened up room for more diverse programming, and anime started to become known in the West once again. In the 80s, Japanese television anime began to become popular among young people overseas. In some countries, adults rejected it, calling it Japanimation and criticizing it as cheap, violent, and sexually explicit. Nevertheless, the anime fan base continues to grow around the world, mostly among young people. Some fans even wonder, why can't our country create works that surpass Japanimation? Today, Japanimation means something quite different from the negative connotations it used to have. In Japan, one of the most significant animated movies ever appeared on movie screens in 1983, Barefoot Gin, faced head-on the subject of bombing Hiroshima in World War II. In that same year, computer-generated animation was first used in a movie, but GoGo 13, The Professional, was not a hit, despite being based on a respected manga series. 1983 is a significant year for a third reason. It was when the first OVA appeared, an OVA meaning original animated video, or direct video. In a not especially memorable space opera called Dallas, because OVAs did not have to be made under the same considerations as theatrical movies or broadcast television, many formats and topics could be explored that would be avoided in the theater or on TV. And because it came on videotapes intended for purchase and home viewing, it could be imported by individuals in the West and sometimes even carried by video rental shops. Robotech was imported from Japan to the U.S. in 1985, and it was actually an amalgamation of three separate Japanese series called Macross, and is still beloved for its innovation. Robotech was the first introduction to anime for many Western fans now in their late 30s and 40s. In the early 1980s, Miyazaki began a science fiction comic book adventure, Nausicaa, the Valley of the Wind, for Animage, an animation fan magazine from one of Japan's largest publishers, Tokuma. This led to a Tokuma-financed feature, which Miyazaki also directed. The 1984 Nausicaa was a smash success, resulting in Tokuma subsidizing a new animation studio, Studio Ghibli, for the personal theatrical features of Miyazaki and his friend Takahata. Studio Ghibli has released an average of a feature a year since then, alternating between the productions of Miyazaki and Takahata. Many of these have become Japan's top-grossing theatrical films, live-action or animated. Takahata's Pompoko was also submitted as Japan's candidate for being an Academy Awards nominee for the Best Foreign Film Oscar. For others, their first anime came in the form of the movie Akira, which appeared on Japanese screens in 88, and then in the US in 89, and then in the UK in 1990. Of any anime, Akira was probably had the most impact on viewers who until then had no idea what anime was. Getting into the 90s, although there was a considerable slump in TV aired anime in the early 90s, certain channels remained anime-friendly. TV Tokyo chief among them, followed by local and regional stations, satellite channels, and other communication systems. Unfortunately, these smaller channels tend to have smaller budgets than the main stations, with predictable consequences for production costs. But the real unstoppable force of anime in the West was a handful of television shows that appeared in the 90s. In 1995 came Sailor Moon, the blueprint for the Magical Girl show. The series gained devoted fans all over the world, and those fans demonstrated their power as an organized group when they successfully rallied to get the rest of the series dubbed into English. Also introduced in 95 was the sci-fi thriller Ghost in the Shell. Other blockbusters of the 90s include Dragon Ball Z, based on the manga by Akira Toriyama, and Pokemon. Both are prime examples of shonen or boys anime, and as other kids' shows like Digimon, Monster Rancher, girls' anime Card Captors, or Card Captor Soccer in Japan, also did well on Western TV networks, not to mention on home video. Broadcasters were much more willing to take chances with more diverse series, including some aired at older aimed at older audiences, such as Tenchi Muyo. And of course, the animation styles of Japanese shows began to have a considerable influence on Western animation. Eventually, this influence made collaborations between Eastern and Western animation studios a logical step, resulting in shows like Hero Man, a TV series made by Studio Bones based on a concept by American comics icon Stan Lee. And Hollywood's love of the remake has meant that live-action or live-action plus CG movies based on Japanese animation are becoming ever more common. Getting back to Disney, though Japanese animation had seen several theatrical releases in the West over the years, it didn't necessarily reach a wide audience. When Disney signed a deal with Studio Ghibli, that changed. In 1999, Disney brought Princess Mononoke, 2 years after its release, to the U.S. Many people went to see it just because it had the Disney name on it. Soon people were going to see the anime distributed by Disney because they were Miyazaki films, and then just because they were anime. Moving on to Toonami. Toonami was an anime programming block originally launched in March 1997 by Sean Atkins and Jason DeMarco for William Street on Cartoon Network. What originally was known as the Moltar area, as it was featured on the Space Ghost character Moltar as the MC or announcer launching program from a remote asteroid-based building called Ghost Planet Industries. This early programming block featured Thundercats, Voltron, The Real Adventures of Johnny Quest, and a sampler of cartoons such as Birdman and Herculoids. Toonami 98 brought forth many staples of Toonami to come: Transformers Beast Wars, Dragon Ball Z, Robotech, Super Friends, and Sailor Moon. In 99, Toonami rebranded itself, introducing TOM, or the Toonami Operations Module, and its bulbous spaceship, the Absolution, as it was introduced.
Objectives remain the same. My name is Tom. I'm the new Moltar. Welcome aboard the Ghost Planet Spaceship Absolution, Cartoon Network's first and only interstellar broadcast and exploration vehicle. I'll give you the tour later. From this day forward, she is completely responsible for all Toonami transmissions. I'm taking you guys into the new millennium. No big changes now, same show, same attitude. A new place to do it, new guy to do it with. I'm not gonna waste any more time. Let's get back into it. Later.
Also introduced was the Midnight Run, a 5-hour Saturday night block. It consisted of anime such as Sailor Moon, Voltron, Robotech, Dragon Ball Z, Gundam Wing, G Gundam, Gundam, 8th MS Team, and Outlaw Star. The Midnight Run tended to have more blood and violence than its daytime counterpart, at one point even running an actual uncut version of Gundam Wing. It also featured music videos from the Gorillaz, including Clint Eastwood and Kenna's Hellbent, and Daft Punk's Interstellar 555 and Harder, Best, Better, Faster, Stronger. Starting in September 2000, Toonami presented special interactive events known as the Total Immersion Events, or TIEs. The first TIE was The Intruder, which introduced Tom's companion, an AI matrix known as Sarah. It introduced the Absolution being attacked by an alien blob known only as The Intruder, which ultimately devoured Tom. Which leads us to Tom 2, between 2000 and 2003. Though the intruder resulted in the destruction of Tom, he was soon after upgraded by Sarah in a short Bomberman-esque character to a taller, sleeker, deeper-voiced incarnation dubbed Tom 2, voiced by Stephen Blum, who has since been the voice of all subsequent incarnations of the character. Stephen Blum said that, "I believe it was Sheen and Jason who first contacted me. As I recall, they said they were fans of Cowboy Bebop and were thinking of me to host their show based on the voice of Spike. I'd never done anything like that before, nor had been approached to even audition for anything like that, so I was excited to meet them. They also offered me free beer, but I didn't know that Toonami was what Toonami was at first. Once I realized what Toonami was, and I may have peed myself a little at the prospect of working on a show that actually respected dubbed anime. I can't take credit for anything regarding Tom except my love for the character. Jason, Sean, Gil, Dennis, always reminded me that there has to be an underlying sense of snark with Tom. He's just a regular dude in a robot body who loves what he loves and isn't afraid to express it." A Saturday morning incarnation, Toonami Rising Sun, ran from 2000 to 2003 at 9 a.m. to noon. This block was somewhat hampered to avoid competing with sister network Kids WB. During the week of February 24th through 28th, of 2003, Cartoon Network aired on Toonami The Giant Robot Week, a 5-day special based on mecha series which were licensed by AD Vision. Getting into the Tom 3 era, in 2003, March, Tom was revamped into a more muscular figure, and this was explained in-universe by him being rebuilt after fighting a space pirate. In April 17th of 2004, Toonami was moved from weekday afternoons to a Saturday evening slot where it aired regularly for 4 hours starting at 7 p.m. It aired for a new demographic of preteen and teen audience while adding a new lighter-toned action block, Magoozy, to weekdays in its place. Toonami also replaced the block known as Saturday Video Entertainment System, or SVES. One reason for the move from weekdays to Saturday nights was because some of the shows on the weekday lineup became too violent for a weekly broadcast. The new Toonami showcased anime such as Naruto, Rave Master, Duel Masters, Gundam Seed, One Piece, Zatch Bell, and Pokemon Chronicles, as well as North American productions including Teen Titans, Megas XLR, Justice League, IGPX. Toonami's first and only original production, co-produced by Production IG and Bandai Entertainment. Sarah got a full body during this period and became more anime-esque. Although Megas XLR was the first original American-made franchise to actually debut on the block, it was initially a Cartoon Network original that was planned to air on Friday nights. Other Cartoon Network action properties, namely Samurai Jack, Teen Titans, and Justice League, aired on Toonami. Getting into Tom 4, or better known as the Thomas the Tank Engine Abomination and Death of Toonami. January 27 of 2007, a teaser commercial aired during the Zaolin Showdown marathon on Cartoon Network, featuring a close-up shots of the larger Clydes, which were the remote robot explorers that have been in Toonami since the beginning, along with the date 3/17/07. Tom's chest emblem was also glowing blue. On March 17th, Toonami celebrated its 10th anniversary with a new packaging and numerous montages celebrating the block. Tom was revamped into a shorter robot who was a commander of a jungle control room and aided by two new robots, Flash and Dee. The montages included a look at past hosts, former logos, and a decade's worth of clips and voiceovers from the shows that aired on Toonami. These were a total of 4 montages, each with different clips, and 3 were 1 minute long. On September 20th, 2008, at the Anime Weekend Atlanta Convention in Atlanta, Georgia, Cartoon Network announced that they had canceled the Toonami block due to low ratings. Toonami then aired its final broadcast the same evening. You can look for yourselves at the tiny lineup and see why there were such low ratings. Getting into the Tom 3.5 area, better known as the Adult Swim Revival and Uncut. On April 1st, 2012, Adult Swim aired the Toonami block for their annual April Fool's Day prank. After airing that week's scheduled episode of Bleach, Toonami-related programming continued through the night, featuring such shows as DBZ, Mobile Suit Gundam, or Gundam Wing, Tenchi Muyo Ryo Oki, Outlaw Star, and Yu Yu Hakusho. The following day, Adult Swim posted a message to their Twitter page simply stating, "Want it back? Let us know. Bring back Toonami." On April 4th, Adult Swim followed up this tweet with one stating, hashtag bring back Toonami, we've heard you. Thank you for your passion and interest. Stay tuned. On May 16th, Adult Swim posted another message on Facebook announcing that Toonami would return on May 26th. The network issued a press release later that day confirming the block's revival as a Saturday late night action block. When Toonami returned, with an initial lineup consisting of the current Adult Swim action programs, such as Dead Man Wonderland and Cashern's Sins. In essence, the revived block is very similar to the midnight run of the original, airing uncut programming as well as having more mature themes. From there, Toonami continued to add programming, such as the Tom 5 era, from 2013 on. On April 27, 2013, Toonami premiered its new look featuring the return of supporting host Sarah after being removed in 07. Toonami introduced a new look on April 6th, and this new look also featured the return of the Ninja Tune record label for Toonami. Getting into the other channels, while no history of anime would be complete without Toonami, it was far from the only channel providing anime in the early 2000s. Kids WB, as mentioned earlier, had a programming block that was in competition with Fox Kids, if anybody remembers Spider-Man and X-Men. And Cartoon Network themselves, of course, was also in competition. Early shows going back to 99 included Pokemon, Card Captors, Yu-Gi-Oh!, Astro Boy, Mega Man NT Warrior, and Beautiful Joe. By 2005, Kids WB was on the chopping block due to requests and lack of interest from Time Warner and CBS Corp. Magoozie at Cartoon Network had largely replaced and absorbed the viewership by this time, and Kids WB was closed December of 2005. Several times it was rebranded and then sold to different parties. All that remains now is WB Kids Go, which is a streaming portal website. The Anime Network, or Anime Network on Cable, was a subsidiary of ADV Films. From June 30th, 2004 to January 4th, 2008, the Anime Network offered a 24/7 channel to cable and satellite providers. The service was only carried by small cable companies, and the network that still operates a small video-on-demand service or streaming service. Anime Unleashed. Tech TV, or formerly ZDTV, had a late-night anime programming block called Anime Unleashed that ran from December 2002 through March of 2006. It didn't have a witty mascot like Tom, but it did tend to showcase more adult-themed anime as if in competition to the early Adult Swim. It generally ran after the screensavers with Leo Laporte. Tech TV was bought out by the G4 network, and Anime Unleashed was stuck hosting reruns until it was quietly discontinued, much to the irritation of fans, myself included. From 2006 through 2007, the collapse and rebuild. Around 2006, the internet had really kicked off online streaming, and the anime industry was in the midst of an implosion bubble. The reason for this bubble was anime had become super popular in the early 2000s, and retailers were buying massive quantities of DVDs at the time. There was also an issue with quality over quantity, or actually reverse that, quantity over quality. As the distributors had not established a baseline or really understood the demands or interests of the Western market, they essentially bought up anything and everything they could get their hands on. It was a shotgun the wall and see if anything stuck approach. This led to an oversaturation of less than AAA grade anime that had headlined programming blocks like Toonami for so long, and it simply didn't sell. When the titles didn't sell, it came crashing back down on the distributors. Because the stores would return the stock and buy their contract, they did not have to pay for it. This left the distributor holding the bag and still on the hook with the Japanese rights holder for license fees and kickbacks. This is where a lot of mid-2000s bargain bin anime came from. Since online streaming had just recently become the eat-all-you-want buffet, tailored to each individual's particular taste, DVD sales suffered even further. The Japanese businesses that retained these license rights were notoriously difficult to work with and very behind the times. Very few companies in the U.S. tried to tackle the approaching storm of online streaming head-on, such as ADV, who turned the cable and satellite anime network into an online video-on-demand service, but ultimately gained little ground. It was as though the industry had an anchor tied to its ankle, and it was shackled about the wrist and then told to compete in the NBA. You just couldn't play the game it needed to. Much of the voice actor market also underwent a shift in this time, and distributors changed to using more in-house or local-only talent for characters. This was partly out of necessity, as they didn't want to spend on flying actors out to recording studios for roles in series that they had no idea would be a hit or not. As such, a lot of the office staff ended up performing more minor roles than before. Couple all this with the economic and housing market crisis happening in the USA, credit was starting to become hard to get a hold of, and the distributors were negotiating license deals for far more than made fiscal sense, resulting in the US anime market sitting on a bomb. That bomb did go off, ending up with many catalogs of licenses either being sold off at auction or disappearing entirely for many years as a swath of companies shut down. Ultimately, the industry shrunk from almost $5 billion to less than half that in a localized recession. Getting into Crunchyroll, as one of the most notable online streaming sites, Crunchyroll started in 2006 as a for-profit video upload and streaming site that specialized in hosting East Asian videos. Some of the content hosted on Crunchyroll included fan sub versions of these East Asian shows. In 2008, Crunchyroll secured a capital investment of $4.05 million from the venture capital firm Vinrock. The investment drew criticism from anime distributors and licensors Bandai Entertainment and Funimation as the site continued to allow users to upload illegal copies of licensed titles. As the story in the wind goes, Crunchyroll had received a cease and desist letter, and instead of just rolling over and shutting down, as every other site did, they pursued changing to a legitimate business model and acting as a streaming outlet when the industry still had not yet gained legs in the streaming market itself. Crunchyroll eventually began securing legal distribution agreements with companies including Gonzo for an increasing number of titles. On January 8, 2009, after announcing a deal with TV Tokyo to host episodes of Naruto Shippuden, Crunchyroll stated that it was committed to removing all copyright infringing material from its site and hosting only content to which it had legitimate distribution rights. In 2010, Crunchyroll announced its acquisition of the North American DVD rights to 5 centimeters per second. This was the first DVD release that was licensed by Crunchyroll. From there, they gathered more licenses and funding to be one of the top streaming providers of anime today. Funimation can also be said to be responsible for a massive push behind anime towards the end of the popped anime bubble. As a company that had always been run very lean, they were not as entrenched and burdened by the DVD collapse as others. They were able to negotiate and snatch up many series licenses, which led them to moderate successes. Simply put, they were bullish and more able to strike in a downturned economy than their competition. They also found it cheaper to eliminate the costly extras and produce anime series as stripped-down releases. Only recently, as the economy improved and fans were willing to pay more, has this changed around. They also followed the trend of online streamers and began to push more into online markets, eventually coming to the pricing model of simulcasts, which have subtitle translations streamed to English audiences the same or next day the show airs in Japan. And we're going to go ahead and play a video on Toonami from the founder, Sheen Atkins, or Akins. And then we'll finish up with the closing paragraph or two.
My name is Sean Akins. I'm a singer, songwriter. I'm a baker. I work in New York City. I sell snake oil.
Come on.
Hi, I'm Sean Akins. I'm the original creator of Toonami. Oh, how did I get involved in Toonami? I worked at Turner Broadcasting for a long time. I actually did start off delivering the mail there, and then I got a PA job, and then I got like grip jobs and other like entry-level positions into production and stuff. Some friends of mine were working at Cartoon Network way back in 1994, and they called me and asked me if I wanted to help create a franchise in the afternoons, like an after-school block for the children. And we worked for a year to create a new destination, like after school, because I was that kid that used to get off the school bus and I would run home to see Voltron or what the fuck ever was on. And I loved superheroes and I loved all that stuff. So I thought I could recreate something like that for kids like me.
Stand by for action.
I don't know what I've created.
The key thing about Toonami originally is it had zero money. So that means you figure out what you can use that is free. And the characters to choose from were the characters that Cartoon Network owned outright, which was the MGM library and all the old characters, which is the same reason there's a Space Ghost Coast to Coast and all those other shows, because those characters, we controlled the intellectual property. That was a huge driver in selecting Moltar. And if you'll notice, the similarities between the Tom character and the Moltar character is they both have a visor face, which is the cheapest way that you can really do animation. Clay Croker was the voice of Moltar, who has left us. It's very sad, but he worked in the building. He was the voice of Moltar. Super easy to make that animation happen. It was about economics, as most things in animation are. For me, and this is just me personally, Toonami was about the collision of things. Not only was Toonami itself a collision, all day you're watching Wacky Races and Augie Doggie, and then at 4 o'clock, giant robots start cutting monsters in half, right? That's sort of a collision in and of itself. You've got American animation colliding with animation that started in Japan, had been localized, like we're early days at this point. So that was a bit of a collision. And then wrapping that stuff in CGI, also a collision. And then bringing the music to it, like beat-driven electronic music, like hip-hop or dance music, in that world was also a collision.
All strong, all brave, all heroes. Just what I need.
The greatest thing about Toonami is we were able to, beyond like making a promo that told you this show is on at 5 o'clock, we were able to do other freeform stuff that was really just our art. You know, we kind of wanted to make stuff like that, so we just made different things.
Man's greatest inventions, making the impossible possible.
I think it's best if we team up.
I say we go for it.
Yes!
And that gave Toonami a different feeling from the different stuff that you would see, especially on cable. It would just not, people weren't really doing it like that. I think these pieces would come on and you could tell that whoever made this was into the, they love this stuff. And we felt that was super fun, like that's what we wanted to make, and the fans seemed to like it when we put it on Toonami as well. So we made a lot of
mission accepted.
So in the beginning, we launched with like Voltron and Thundercats and these other shows that when I was a kid had come on. So they were really old, and we got those for free. Or very close to free, and it was just something we could put up. So DBZ came on at like 5:30 in the morning on channel 69 in Atlanta, and kids were setting their alarm and like waking up at 6:30 on Sunday or whatever to watch this crazy show. And then my friends started doing it, so I was watching it, and then you would get bootleg VHS tapes. That was when I thought there could be something here, and if kids are willing to get up this early on Sunday and watch this show, what if we put it on at 5 o'clock in the afternoon? What could happen?
That's when everything started to blow up.
And that's when it blew up. I think one of the big drivers for Moltar transitioning to Tom was we wanted to redesign the franchise just in general. I think it had been on for a couple of years, so we just wanted to freshen up and do something different. But we still had all the same rules. We didn't have a lot of money. We still wanted to go with the visor, all that kind of stuff. So we spent a lot of time trying to develop a concept. And most of our shows at the time were like outer space shows, I think. And I was big into creating a place, not a real place, but a theoretical place. So I thought a spaceship as a broadcasting center would be a fun vehicle. So it was really finding a way to convince them that we could do it cost effectively. At that point, I had hired a bunch of guys that were good at it. So we didn't have to really farm a lot of stuff out. We were able to keep the cost down in that way. And then the stuff looked good. So when you start delivering animation and material that looks cool and you're not burning the house down, then they will let you do whatever.
What are you talking about?
So the Total Immersion event, the first one, The Intruder, was really just a fulfillment, we thought, on all the promises that we had made to our fans and to this audience, like going up in it. We had a spaceship, like we had our set. And with CGI, the funny thing about CGI is even though like none of that stuff is real, it actually is kind of real. So once you have built all of the things, like you still have to build models, you still have to build sets, and it's really just like building them in real life, except instead of hammers and nails, you're clicking and dragging and deforming. But a lot of work goes into creating all of that stuff. But then once you have it, it's easy to kind of exploit it, and you can continue to kind of make additional animation, and the more animation you can make, the cheaper all that stuff is if you amateurize your costs over the years. I know you kids are big into amateurized costs. So that was really how those started. We felt like, there's a way to tell a longer story. We can explore our world a little bit more. People can find out more about our host character, who really kind of was confined to a chair, and still is predominantly, and for most of his life. So it was great to get him out of the chair. We never felt like Tom was the reason, and the stuff that we were making was the reason that you were tuning in. We always just felt like we were the framework to bring it to you. But if there's any way that you could sort of elevate that and give people like just more to react to and more to see, we thought that would be better, and that people would like to see that stuff.
Go check it out. Hey, go check it out.
I mean, it was hectic. Like, we'd never done anything like that before. And, you know, we're talking so many years ago. It was back when we really were like, we can do anything. Yeah, we'll make that. Come on. I'll just stay up for 36 hours and we'll make it. Like, we had no brains. You know, you don't think about how hard it is when you're doing something that you love doing. It's like, it's fun. Nothing feels better than creating something from nothing. It's just drawings, or it's just ones and zeros or programs, but then you can actually like make another human being feel something. That's super satisfying when you can do that, because you feel like it's this thing that didn't exist, and because of our efforts or this team or me or whoever, we've now brought this thing into the world, and it has affected other people. So it's a kind of a magic.
You guys ready to make the magic happen?
We're shifting gears into a sadder time. So Tom 4 is still the highest technical achievement that the group ever achieved. That's a horrible way to say that, but if you look at the animation, if you look at the quality of those scenes, it's not better than that. It's not better than that anywhere. So what we thought moving into that stage was, man, we're on top of the mountain. We got a little bit of dough. We got a few guys now. We can take on some bigger challenges. We thought, like, man, maybe we could start making some longer CGI cartoons. We could start doing some longer stuff. To do that, we felt like there's no way anyone is ever going to sign off on a, you know, like a 6-minute or 8-minute story of a guy that you cannot see his face. It seemed like it made sense to me at the time. And it seemed like some of the things that are great in life are people with faces and friends. So, I mean, I thought the work was great. I thought it was super cool. I thought we did a lot of stuff, but yeah, super controversial. People didn't like it. People thought, you know, not my Tom. Hashtag not my Tom, you know. When you make like TV stuff, or you make stuff for companies like this, they don't come in and they're like, guys, we're canceled today. Corporations are a bit more nefarious about that kind of stuff. So what happens is there's less resources this year than the next quarter. And so by the time it's actually canceled, it's like it's been over for like a long time. The network is always searching, any network is always searching to find a larger audience. And when you think that one day part or one show has sort of peaked and the numbers are trailing off, they want to get rid of that and they want to put the next thing on that has a chance to grow even larger. So that's what the network was doing. It was looking for a larger audience, a larger audience than Toonami could draw. And then you're arguing about theoreticals. You're arguing about a potential audience and then an audience that exists. So the advantage of a potential audience is that audience is unlimited in size. So it's hard to win that argument, and Toonami gets canceled.
So, until we meet again, stay gold. Bang.
So it was fun to make it. I'm psyched that it's back. I think it deserves a place in the culture. I think it ushered in the most impactful wave of anime into the United States. It certainly deserves to be part of Cartoon Network just as much as any other thing that Cartoon Network made. And I think it started, a movement is maybe overstated, but I think it started, it started something. So now you look at the anime business, which had no place on television, and what? You got Crunchyroll, you got Hulu, you got Netflix, everybody's showing anime. That didn't happen before. Like, you can thank Toonami for that. What you can do if you like this show is to watch it. People always would come up and ask me, like, why did such and such get canceled? Why did you take off this show? Do I have to tell you? Like, it's a television show. It was canceled because no one was watching it. That's the way it happened. So if you love it, watch Toonami. And the larger audience that Toonami has, the more power they'll have, the more shows that they'll make, the more stuff that they can bring into the country, and the more stuff that they can show you.
I can give it to you here after just a couple minutes. In closing, everything else is you can see for yourself as it is today. Anime once again has returned to mainstream TV with a revitalized Toonami. Online streaming has never been stronger. The industry has largely learned its lesson and tries to gauge feedback to a series in Japan more accurately before dropping the money to import it. Anime is being pushed more and more into Europe and other markets very rapidly. Anime cons are said to be oversaturated now and will have to go through their own reorganization soon. Ultimately, as a whole, anime continues on today, and the only question is what part you will play in its future. Thank you for coming to our panel today, and come see our other Louisville Anime Community events.
Thank you.
And with that, we got to break down.
That was a lot of talk.
Very well, too.
How long did that take to prepare?
I actually hammered out 20 pages in one afternoon.
Oh, my God.
That's
what an expert can do, right?
But we'll be having some other events today. That Toonami video is actually on YouTube. It's the scene. Or Sean Atkins interview. There's actually another video I had that's the 20th anniversary video for Toonami that actually interviews all the founders instead of just one, as well as the voice of Sarah and some other people, but it was about another 5 minutes long, so I didn't have time to run it.
I like that one. That was well chosen. Yeah. So Sean, how does his name spelled? If I try to look. What do you recommend me doing for Googling it or
getting? I would go on YouTube and look up Toonami. And his name is spelled S-E-A-N-A-K-I-N-S, Akins.
E-A-N-A-K-I-N-S. Okay. Just look up Toonami?
Yes.
What's the name of his interview?
It's literally that. Steam, or Sheen, Sean, whatever his name is. Akins interview, Toonami.
Okay.
It's the only one he's done. They did it, actually put it on TV here about 3 weeks ago. I just happened to be watching it at the time and thought, that's a sweet interview. I didn't know some of that. So.
Yeah. I've been doing anime back home. I'll look at that show. I recently was, I'm married to one of the space guests today. And so obviously anime groups were going to go to these cons. And there's something that never had dawned on me until I was watching on C-SPAN, an in-depth futurologist, very scholarly work about the future of industry. And he pointed out that it might be relevant for this art form being more popular in Asia.
Mm-hmm.
Said that in the psyche of at least the Japanese, because of Shintoism, which is an animism-based religion, they're much more receptive to the personification of of robots. And I guess a parallel thought to what he was pointing out is that that might be a reason that they're far more advanced in the robotics industry than we are, because our receptivity to that as embracing that industry into our culture and daily lifestyle.
You've also got Buddhism that took hold in Japan as well. If you look at a lot of anime, you'd end up seeing where some of them are like directly feature Shintoism, like Tenchi in Tokyo. It's all about him taking over the family shrine and going to Tokyo in order to train at a school to become the head priest.
Oh yeah, there's a lot of that.
It's all over the place, really.
I want to see that one. So, like that again, the name of that particular...
That one, that's Tenchi in Tokyo.
Tenchi, how do you spell that one?
T-E-N-C-H-I.
T as in Paul?
T.
T as in Tom.
T-E-N-C-H-I,
Tenchi. It's like Tenchi Muyo, which is more well-known for the OVA series.
Tenchi in Tokyo?
Yeah, it's a spin-off series, actually. A lot of fans kind of got butthurt by it.
But I can tell. What was your most favorite watch show on Toonami?
Gosh.
Hard question.
Most favorite show.
Give me that from the heart.
Yeah, there's at least a half dozen. I mean, I got back into anime. My uncle had given me some copy tapes way back in the 80s, and it was like, here, watch this stuff, kid, and here's 12-hour tapes, And I watched that, and I had nothing for years. I watched a little Speed Racer, saw a little bit of Macross that came on TV in the 80s, stuff like that. But it wasn't until Gundam Wing came on Toonami that I started buying up all kinds of Gundam stuff. I watched it religiously. I started becoming an internet nerd. I was racking up $500 dial-up bills. And I was like, that's what really kicked it off at that point in time. I wouldn't say maybe Gundam Wing was my most favorite show of all time, even among Gundams. I mean, it's good, but then there's the MS team, there's 0083, which we're running in here later tonight. The Blu-ray just came out this week. Fooly Cooly was cool. I mean, I was at a LAC because Anime Unleashed died, and I got really into online communities back then with Dual Parallel Trouble Adventure. And that community was very unique and small and secluded in and of itself, and everybody that kind of liked that series, they all pretty much had the same interests. So it was a nice filter. There's a lot of stuff that's really good out there. Actually, on our website, for the meetup, for a little anime community, I've got a list of like the staples of anime, which is, granted, it's got a lot of Miyazaki movies on there, but stuff like Outlaw Star, things that people, you don't hear about so much anymore. But if you had watched that, you bring it up at an anime convention or something, you say Outlaw Star, or you're wearing an Outlaw Star shirt, and everybody's like, dude, I love that. But
Dragon Ball Z and Gundam, the two shows I watched, because they actually used to not rerun so many of the same episodes from another channel.
You used to have weird stuff.
That was the first time I saw the Frieza Saga. It was a show that's not at the time.
Well, we've got our booth right outside the door here, so if you'd like to pick up a card with our information on it to find out what other events we're doing. We generally run 4 or 5 events a month.
Cool.
So if you'd like to check us out, pick up the card, or come find us.
Thank you,
Dan.
It's really well done.
Thank you.
I'll give you a lot of those cards. He's here. books this time. Sometimes it's a guest of honor for science.
Okay.
Yeah.